At 5:30 a.m. on May the 10th, 1940, Adolf Hitler launched his long-awaited Western offensive, codenamed Case Yellow. This was the moment for which both the Germans and the Allies had been preparing since the previous September. The campaign which followed would see the Germans achieve one of the most stunning victories in the annals of warfare. In the Battle of France, the German army deployed the greatest concentration of tanks ever assembled. Their offensive saw the war's first large-scale airborne operation. Already victorious in Poland and Norway, the Germans would now be meeting forces equal to their own in both manpower and material. Yet with new and revolutionary tactics, the Germans would destroy the armies of Belgium, Holland, and France, and inflict upon the British Army its greatest humiliation since its defeat in the American Revolution. The German campaign would leave Hitler as undisputed master of Western Europe and give his army an aura of invincibility. So complete was its victory that 4 years would pass before Germany's supremacy in France and the Low Countries could again be challenged. On March the 12th, 1938, Hitler sent his army into Austria and annexed it to the Reich. Though the invasion openly flouted international law, neither Britain nor France made any protest. Encouraged by his victory, Hitler turned his attention toward Czechoslovakia. He began demanding the return of the Sudetenland, a Czech region inhabited by ethnic Germans. International tension over the issue mounted steadily to the point where war seemed certain. Eventually, in September 1938, the leaders of France, Britain, Germany, and Italy met at Munich to resolve the crisis. Eager at all costs to avoid war, the Western powers yielded to all of Hitler's demands. The Czechs were given no say in the carving up of their country. Britain hoped that peace in Europe was now assured and that Hitler would pose no further threat. This illusion was shattered within 6 months when in March 1939, the Germans occupied the rump of Czechoslovakia. Britain was outraged and promptly abandoned its policy of appeasement. On the 31st of March, Britain and France promised to guarantee the independence of Poland, where it seemed Hitler would strike next. Just 3 days later, Hitler ordered his generals to draw up plans for Poland's destruction. His main objective was to regain territories ceded to the Poles after the Great War. He felt sure the Allies would not actually go through with their threat to fight. In August 1939, he stunned world opinion by signing a non-aggression pact with the Soviet Union, his most hated enemy. A secret clause in the pact arranged for the partition of Poland between the two powers. With Russian complicity thus assured, Hitler massed 59 divisions along the Polish borders and prepared to launch them in converging attacks. The German formations included over 2,500 tanks and 2,000 Luftwaffe fighters and bombers. The Polish forces facing them were spread out all along the 1,750 miles of the frontiers with Germany. They comprised seven armies, totaling 30 active divisions and 10 reserve divisions. They also possessed 12 large cavalry brigades, 475 tanks, and 445 aircraft. On September the 1st, Hitler's armies surged across the Polish frontiers. In the north, the German Third Army advanced from East Prussia and the Fourth Army from Pomerania. In the south, 8th and 10th Armies attacked from Silesia and 14th Army from Slovakia. By the 5th of September, 4th Army had secured the Danzig Corridor and was moving southeast alongside 3rd Army. By the 7th of September, 10th Army had advanced northeast to within 30 miles of Warsaw, cutting off Polish forces before they could reach the River Vistula. The main basis of German success in Poland was an entirely new tactic, which came to be called Blitzkrieg, or lightning war. Blitzkrieg relied on the deployment of armored forces in entire divisions. These panzer divisions consisted of both light and heavy tanks, motorized infantry, artillery and reconnaissance units. Once the massed heavy tanks had punched their way through enemy defenses, the breach would be consolidated and widened by the following wave of light tanks and infantry. The forward units continued their advance, carrying the battle into enemy rear areas. A key element in Blitzkrieg was the close ground support provided by the Luftwaffe, whose airstrikes helped isolate frontline forces and cut them off from any logistic support. In the skies over Poland, the Luftwaffe rapidly achieved total aerial supremacy. Attacks against Polish airfields wiped out a large portion of the Polish Air Force on the first day of the war. The Luftwaffe struck hard at key military installations, supply lines, and rail networks. Indeed, the Germans were all too familiar with the layout of the Polish railway system, having built it themselves. On the 10th of September, the Poles began a general retreat toward the southeast of their country. On the 15th of September, the German Third Army completed its northern pincer movement. Fourth and 14th Armies completed the encirclement from the east by September the 17th. Poland's fate was sealed when, on that same day, some 41 Russian divisions crossed her near defenseless eastern frontiers. By September the 23rd, they had effortlessly occupied the zone allotted to them under the Nazi-Soviet pact. Meanwhile, the Germans mopped up the final pockets of resistance. Overwhelmed by ferocious Luftwaffe bombing raids, Warsaw finally surrendered at 2 p.m. on September the 27th. The German victory had been achieved with the loss of only 44,000 casualties, compared to total Polish losses of nearly a million in killed, wounded, and captured. 2 days after the launch of the Polish invasion, France and Britain, in line with their earlier guarantees, declared war on Germany. However, Poland's geographical location and the swiftness of the German victory prevented them from intervening directly. The French briefly advanced across Germany's western border, but upon hearing of Poland's defeat, they withdrew. In September, the first detachments of the British Expeditionary Force, or BEF, began taking up positions along the Franco-Belgian border. By the end of the month, 13 British divisions were in place, numbering over 150,000 men. 21,000 vehicles accompanied the BEF to France, along with almost all of Britain's heavy military equipment. The French and British troops dug in and waited for the expected German attack in the west. No attack came, and for the next 8 months, hostilities would be limited to sporadic artillery duels and bombing raids. The next major German offensive was directed not at France, but Scandinavia. In April 1940, German troops moved to occupy Denmark and Norway. They were sent to protect Germany's supplies of iron ore, which were shipped out from Sweden through the Norwegian port of Narvik. By occupying Norway, Germany would also secure bases for air attacks against Allied shipping in the North Sea and keep the Royal Navy from the Baltic. The Allies had already realized that severing Germany's iron ore supply would cripple the Nazi war machine, and they were simultaneously planning their own operation in Norway. The Germans narrowly won the ensuing race. On April the 9th, German troops landed at Kristiansund, Bergen, Trondheim, and Narvik. Supporting airborne assaults were made against Oslo and Stavanger. This was the first major air-land-sea operation in history. On the same day, and in the space of 4 hours, the Germans occupied Denmark. By April the 16th, Germany controlled most of southern Norway. Despite heroic resistance, Norway's largely militia army had been unable to prevent the German capture of their coastal cities. Over the next 3 days, British and French troops landed at Namsos, Narvik, and Andalsnes. In the south, they advanced as far as Lillehammer, but were then repulsed and had to be withdrawn by early May. In the north, they pushed the Germans out of Narvik. However, the Allied campaign was doomed by poor coordination, especially between the navy and infantry, while the total air supremacy achieved by the Luftwaffe proved decisive. The outcome of the Norwegian campaign was a foregone conclusion. Even before the fighting had finished there, the Germans were preparing to launch their greatest gamble of all, the invasion and conquest of the West. After his lightning conquest of Poland, Hitler had hoped the Allies would accept the German victory, just as they had earlier accepted the occupation of Austria and Czechoslovakia. Once he saw they were determined to fight, he had resolved to launch a Western offensive as soon as possible. He knew the Allies would need time to mobilize fully and to draw on the resources of their overseas colonies. If given this time, they would be too strong for Germany to defeat. It was essential, therefore, that the German army should attack while it still had the initiative. His first strategic priority was to defeat the French army in the field. Once this was achieved, he felt confident that Britain would would sue for peace. Much of Hitler's military outlook had been shaped by his time as a frontline soldier on the Western Front during the Great War. Many of his generals had been staff or artillery officers during World War I, and as such, would not have fought in the trenches. On this basis, Hitler distrusted their opinions and frequently overruled them. Indeed, all his military initiatives to date had been taken against the express advice of the High Command. Each one of these had succeeded, and for Hitler, these successes amounted to victories over his own generals as well as the enemy. Hitler's decision to go to war with Britain and France deeply dismayed his commanders. They neither shared his grand ambitions of conquest nor believed the army was strong enough to realize them. Their opposition to Hitler was weakened after his run of successes. The High Command was also indebted to him for restoring the army's power and prestige. Hitler could also count on the support of the rank and file, who hero worshipped him. By the spring of 1940, Hitler's leadership was secure and the army's loyalty was guaranteed. On the 21st of March 1940, Paul Reynaud became France's prime minister. 2 years earlier, as Minister of Finance, he had effected major improvements in the French economy. Aged 62, he now found himself at the head of a government and a country that had long been torn by bitter political divisions. Militarily, he was a hardliner against Germany and wanted France to adopt a more aggressive attitude. Upon taking office, he immediately cooperated with Britain in planning and executing the Allied intervention in Norway. Yet time and again, Renault's initiatives were blocked by his numerous enemies. He was also at loggerheads with his senior military commanders. He had long argued, though without success, for the formation of armored corps in the French army. The eve of the German offensive found Renault's government virtually paralyzed by disunity. Before becoming Prime Minister in 1937, Neville Chamberlain had been Minister of Health and Chancellor of the Exchequer. He believed that peace in Europe could best be achieved by making concessions to Germany, even though he had a deep personal dislike of Hitler. It was a belief shared by many people in Britain. And when Chamberlain returned home after signing the Munich Agreement, he received a hero's welcome. But while appeasing Hitler on the political front, Chamberlain also oversaw British preparations for the possibility of war. In 1938, he introduced rearmament. The regular army received new weapons and vehicles, as well as improved salaries and living conditions. The Territorial Army Reserve was reorganized and expanded. Following Germany's takeover of Czechoslovakia, Chamberlain quickly introduced conscription and stepped up the pace of rearmament. He also arranged for the British Expeditionary Force to go to France in September 1939. His political standing, however, had been badly undermined by his earlier policy of appeasement. He had also spurned Russian offers of an alliance, thus paving the way for the Nazi-Soviet pact. His political fate would be sealed by the defeat of the Allied expedition in Norway. On the first day of the German offensive in the West, Chamberlain would be forced to resign. The man who would replace him had been one of his sternest opponents and an arch critic of appeasement. At the outbreak of war, Winston Churchill was First Lord of the Admiralty. He was one of Britain's most experienced politicians, having held 8 cabinet positions in a 40-year career, interspersed with frequent spells in the political wilderness. In 1938, he had even considered retiring from public life. Churchill had been one of the fiercest critics of the pre-war policy of appeasement and was absolutely unshakable in his opposition to Hitler. He was largely responsible for planning and directing the Allied campaign in Norway, but escaped serious criticism for its failure. In spite of his great experience, Churchill was only a compromise choice for Prime Minister. Though the support he received was less than wholehearted, he himself had complete self-belief. He would later remark that assuming the leadership felt like walking with destiny. Within a week of defeating Poland, Hitler had issued a directive stating that Germany should launch an attack against France through the Low Countries as quickly as possible. Hitler dismissed his general's objections to this order as defeatist and insisted on the operation going ahead. At once, the German High Command prepared their first plan for the Western Offensive, codenamed Case Yellow. Case Yellow gave the major role to the Army's right wing, Army Group B, which would overwhelm the Belgian forces along the line of the Albert Canal and then push towards the Somme. Army Group A, in the center, would attack through southern Belgium in support, while Army Group C held the Franco-German frontier in a largely static role. Case Yellow was virtually a repeat of the German invasion plan of 1914. Hitler had misgivings about this version of Case Yellow, noting that its proposed advance had to be made across difficult terrain. Worse still, it seemed likely to lead to the sort of static war of attrition he had himself endured in the trenches of World War I. He suggested making an attack against the Allied center. Over the ensuing months, the High Command prepared several minor variations of Case Yellow, none of which quite satisfied him. In any case, the onset of winter forced Hitler to postpone his offensive time and again. The Germans now began studying a fifth and very different version of Case Yellow, known as Sickle Stroke. Sickle Stroke required Army Group B, now much reduced in size, to attack Belgium and Holland. First, airborne troops would be parachuted into Rotterdam, where they would seize the aerodromes. Paratroops would also be used to secure bridges over Belgium's Albert Canal and to capture the vital fortress of Eben-Emael. Next, The Luftwaffe was to attack airfields in Belgium, Holland, and France, destroying enemy aircraft before they even had a chance to take off. Finally, the main body of Army Group B was to commence its advance. Its main purpose was to lure the Franco-British forces into the Belgian lowlands. In the south, facing the formidable fixed defenses of France's Maginot Line, Army Group C was to engage its defenders and effect a breakthrough if possible. The main effort was to be delivered by the strongest German force, Army Group A, in the center, spearheaded by 7 armored and 3 motorized divisions. Army Group A would attack across the dense forest of the Ardennes through Luxembourg and southern Belgium. Bypassing the Maginot Line, they were to cross the Meuse between Dinan and Sedan, then break out toward the Somme. By so doing, they would drive a huge wedge in the center of the Allied armies. If all went to plan, Sickle-Stroke could yield a decisive victory. Its very boldness had deterred the High Command when it was first laid before them in November. Since then, there'd been time to perfect its details. When Sickle-Stroke was finally put to Hitler in February 1940, that same boldness appealed to him instinctively. Furthermore, Sickle-Stroke was in line with his own earlier suggestion that an attack might be possible against the Allied center. Its adoption was thus assured. From that point on, all the deliberations and preparations of the General Staff were geared entirely towards its successful realization. For months on end, its every aspect was carefully rehearsed in elaborate training exercises. By May the 10th, 1940, every German soldier, from the highest rank to the lowest, knew exactly what was expected of him if victory was to be achieved. France's principal system of defense was the Maginot Line. The line was an extensive bulwark of fortifications deemed impossible to breach. This elaborate defensive network contained numerous tank traps, mines, fortified machine gun emplacements, anti-tank, anti-aircraft, and heavy field artillery. The forts were all linked by connecting lifts and tunnels. They could supply their own needs of water and power, and the largest could accommodate a garrison of 1,000 men. France had spent a staggering 7,000 million francs in building the Maginot Line, by far the greater part of her overall defense budget. Due to the strength of the Maginot defenses, French strategists were certain the Germans would have to repeat their 1914 attack through Belgium and Holland. However, in planning how to meet this threat, they were immediately faced with the problem of Belgian neutrality. The Belgians were afraid of provoking Germany by being seen to align themselves with Britain and France. They were also worried that a close alliance with France would antagonize their Flemish population, who harbored strong anti-French sentiments. They therefore pursued a policy of strict neutrality. Allied troops were forbidden to enter Belgium unless the country was actually attacked. They were denied the chance of familiarizing themselves with the terrain, or even of learning the battle plans of the Belgian army. Eventually, the Allies developed the strategy known as the Deal Plan, or Plan D. Once the Germans attacked, the French 1st and 7th Armies and the BEF, the most mobile Allied forces, would advance into Belgium and occupy a line running from Antwerp to Namur along the Deal River. Here, they hoped to link up with the Belgian army. To their right, the French 9th Army would deploy along the River Meuse from Namur to the French border. In March 1940, the modification known as the Breda variant was added. This required the French 7th Army on the left to proceed even further to Breda so as to form a continuous Allied Dutch-Belgian front. South of this, the French 2nd Army Group was to man the Maginot Line. And in the center of the Allied position, a small covering force of 5 divisions would be stationed behind the Ardennes Forest. Because the Ardennes was considered impassable, no anti-tank or anti-aircraft weapons were given to these troops. To the north, both Belgium and Holland had evolved their own independent strategies to counter a German invasion. Belgium's first line of defense ran along the Albert Canal. Its linchpin was the formidable Fort Ebony Mail, and there were fieldworks with machine gun posts every 500 to 800 yards. But the Belgians did not expect to be able to hold this line for long. They subsequently planned to fall back on a line from Antwerp to Namur, known as the KW Line. The same line that the French would advance to as part of their Deal Plan. Since November 1939, they had been fortifying this sector, and by May of the following year had erected hundreds of pillboxes along it, a small percentage of which were earmarked for occupation by the French and British. The Dutch, too, had decided to defend only part of their country. This was the vital economic area located between the 3 large rivers of the Meuse, Waal, and Rhine. The Dutch army was to fight delaying actions on the Grebbe Line and would then withdraw and resort to the traditional tactics of deliberate flooding to impede the enemy. The Allies' prospects of repelling the German invasion would depend entirely on factors beyond their control. Firstly, the Belgians would have to delay the Germans long enough for the Allies to occupy the Deal Line. Next, there would have to be perfect coordination between the various forces. This coordination would have to be worked out in the very heat of battle. Above all, the Germans would have to attack precisely where the Allied strategists expected they would. The commander-in-chief of the German army was General Walter von Brüchitsch. 58 years old, he was a decorated veteran of the First World War, an excellent linguist and student of world affairs. A highly intelligent officer, he was Hitler's personal choice to become commander-in-chief in 1938. However, he lacked the strength of character to stand up to Hitler. Like many of his colleagues, Brohich doubted the wisdom of launching a Western offensive. When he voiced these doubts to Hitler, he was so fiercely berated, he never again dared to question the Führer's directives. In November 1939, Brohich was presented with the first draft of the Sickle-Stroke Plan. Its author was Lieutenant General Fritz Erich von Manstein, one of the keenest operational minds in the German army. Brohich thought Sickle-Stroke unfeasible and dismissed it. But Manstein kept lobbying for its acceptance until at last Brohich lost patience and transferred him to a command in the East. Soon afterwards, in February, Manstein met Hitler and described his plan to him. The very next day, Brohich was ordered to adopt Sickle-Stroke, which the Führer presented as his own idea. Over the following weeks, as he oversaw the rehearsals for Sickle-Stroke, Brohich himself came to appreciate its potential. His troops had also benefited from months of training and reorganizing. Despite his cautious nature, Brohich felt the army at last had a real chance of victory. The supreme commander of the Allied forces in France was General Maurice Gamelin. He was aloof and felt ill at ease amongst his troops. He preferred to spend his time at his headquarters, cut off from the men. In May 1940, Gamelin's command was made up of four operational areas. The most important of these was in the northeast, facing Germany. Gamelin retained direct control of planning and strategy, leaving his frontline commanders in charge of operations and liaisons with each other. It was a desperately flawed command structure, characterized by inefficient coordination and communication. To make matters worse, Gamelin had fallen out with his key commanders. The BEF commander, Lord John Gort, was disturbed by the blatant weakness of the French command structure. But as he was subordinate to Gamelin, he could do little about it. Gamelin had been a staff officer during the First World War, and the strategies of that era still dominated his outlook. He believed that infantry still reigned supreme on the battlefield. He discounted the idea that tanks, on their own, could breach a continuous line of defense. As the lessons of the Polish campaign were pondered, he confidently asserted that his forces could contain and cut off any possible breakthrough by panzers. Gamelin's passive strategy infuriated France's new prime minister, Paul Reynaud, who called him a nerveless philosopher. Twice in April, and again on the very eve of the German invasion, he tried to have Gamelin dismissed. However, each time the general's political supporters had stepped in to save him. France's fate would now rest in his hands. Germany had mustered 136 divisions for its assault on France. No more than a third were fully experienced and equipped, and these would all be committed in the attack's first wave. In spite of Blitzkrieg's reliance on mobile forces, the army was far from being entirely motorized and had only 120,000 trucks. Many of its guns still had to be horse-drawn. Because Germany lacked the military and industrial resources for a long war, it needed swift victories. Blitzkrieg provided the method by which such victories could be secured. It required the close cooperation of all arms, especially between the army and air force. To achieve this, Luftwaffe ground crews accompanied the panzer divisions to help coordinate air and ground attacks. At the war's outbreak, the Luftwaffe was Europe's largest and most powerful air force. Its planes were deployed in semi-autonomous fleets, the aerial equivalent of panzer divisions. The Luftwaffe largely functioned in a sophisticated army support role, typified by such planes as the highly effective Stuka dive bomber. Because most of its planes were short range, the Luftwaffe needed to occupy and operate from captured enemy airfields. Over 4,000 Luftwaffe planes would take part in the Battle of France, giving it a numerical superiority of almost 2-1 over the Allied air forces. By May 1940, German panzer strength stood at over 2,500 machines. Individually, the German tanks held no clear advantage in either armor or firepower, but their deployment in armored divisions guaranteed them battlefield superiority at the point of contact. Each armored division included about 240 tanks, as well as supporting vehicles. These divisions would have a decisive and dramatic influence in the coming conflict. The Panzer II was first produced in 1935. It featured a new suspension system using five large, independently sprung road wheels. Though heavier than the Panzer I, it was also faster and more powerful. Panzer IIs would be committed in the battle for France, almost half of the army's total tank strength. Its 20mm cannon was a converted aircraft gun and would be no match for many of the Allied tanks. It was essentially a lightly armed scout tank. The Panzer III was intended as Germany's main battle tank and was expected to make up 75% of an armored division's strength. It was primarily designed to fill an anti-tank role and was equipped with the same anti-tank gun that was used by the infantry. Problems in development meant that only 350 were available at the beginning of the Western Offensive. The Panzer III had six small road wheels per side, each independently sprung on a torsion bar. Very little of its suspension system was exposed to enemy weapons. However, difficulties with rough terrain caused this type of suspension to be abandoned in later models. In 1938, it was decided to upgrade the Panzer III's main gun to 50mm, but this new model was not ready when the offensive began. During the course of the campaign, 40 upgunned Panzer IIIs were to see action. Panzer IV was designed as an infantry support tank and equipped with a short, low-velocity gun firing high explosive shells. It was designed to deal with enemy infantry and anti-tank guns. Its suspension system was a simple bogey arrangement, using quarter elliptical springs. Though first planned in 1935, it wasn't until 1939 that the Panzer IV finally came off the production line. Though intended to make up 25% of an armored division's strength, the 278 tanks which fought in France constituted only 2% of total German armored strength. With gun changes, it was to be the mainstay of the Panzer Force throughout the war. The Panzer 38T was originally a Czech tank and had been the mainstay of the Czech army. An excellent, well-armored light tank, it came into German possession with the occupation of Czechoslovakia in 1939. Over 400 38Ts took part in the Western Offensive. In just 7 years, the German army had grown from 100,000, the figure permitted by the Versailles Treaty, to a grand total of 3.5 million. Of these, 2.5 million would be committed to the Western Offensive. A large percentage of German troops were conscripts, drafted from the brown shirts, the police, and elsewhere. By May 1940, the army's morale could not have been higher. To the earlier bloodless conquests of Austria and the Czechs, they could now add their well-fought victories in Poland and Norway. These campaigns gave the ordinary German soldier complete confidence in his training, equipment, and leadership. The German troops were well paid and received generous home leave, factors which further boosted their morale. Though discipline was strict, relations between the men and their officers were very good, and a strong spirit of comradeship was fostered throughout the army. Alongside the regular army, Germany would field three divisions of the Waffen-SS, totaling 100,000 men. It had been founded in March 1939 as the military wing of the Nazi Party's elite SS organization. It had been arranged that should war break out, it would come under army command. Entry standards were rigorous. Out of every 100 applicants, only 7 were accepted. The SS were the first German units to train with live ammunition and to be issued with camouflage jackets. SS divisions were all motorized. Highly organized and fanatically loyal to Hitler, they were intended to be used as shock troops. Although Hitler was intensely proud of these, his personal regiments, the Waffen-SS were initially mistrusted by the army, who regarded them as amateur soldiers. However, they fought well in Poland, thereby earning a reputation for courage and discipline. In the battle for France, Germany would field a highly organized and motivated fighting force. By May 1940, 94 French divisions, containing 2.25 million men, were deployed to meet the expected German attack. However, much of their artillery dated from the First World War, and they were dangerously short of effective anti-tank and anti-aircraft guns. French and British tactical doctrine regarding tanks and aircraft lagged far behind the Germans. Both the high commands considered tanks as first and foremost an infantry support weapon. The few French armored divisions formed by 1940 contained only half as many tanks as their German counterparts. Between them, the Allies deployed 3,100 tanks in May 1940, but they were widely dispersed amongst the infantry divisions. As for the French Air Force, it could field only 740 modern fighters and 140 effective light or medium bombers. These were reinforced by 350 aircraft from Britain's RAF, attached to the BEF. The Allied aircraft were dispersed amongst the different areas of the front in just the same way as the armored forces were. This made it impossible for individual army commanders to obtain a sufficient concentration of air power at the right moment. This shortcoming would be one of the major factors in the outcome of the Battle of France. The French Army's standard light tank from 1935, the R-35, was used in an infantry support role. 855 R-35s equipped the army in May 1940, making it France's most numerous tank. Extremely slow, it was unsuitable for mobile strategic operations. Like all French tanks, its effectiveness was limited by the fact that its commander had also to act as gunner, loader, and radio operator. First developed in the mid-1930s, the Char B was a formidable weapon, with thicker armor than any panzer. It mounted a 47mm gun in a revolving turret, backed up by a 75mm gun in the hull. Though limited by a short operating range of 85 miles, the Char B could cope with any German tank pitted against it. Like other French tanks, it was poorly deployed by the army command. The Matilda II would prove to be the best British tank in the Battle of France. It was one of the earliest tanks to have a hydraulically controlled turret. Designed purely for infantry support, its cross-country speed was little faster than walking pace. The Matilda was the best protected tank of its day, but it suffered somewhat from poor vision and mobility. During the interwar years, the French army was regarded as the most formidable in Europe. By 1939, this reputation no longer stood up to close scrutiny. Throughout the 1930s, recruitment had fallen and funding declined due to the Depression and the large costs of the Maginot Line. The troops received only 50 centimes a day, compared to a British private's daily allowance of 17 francs. This caused great resentment amongst the French rank and file. Their living conditions were uncomfortable and impoverished. Discipline was lax, with soldiers often neglecting to salute their officers and even leaving their barracks each weekend without permission. Many of the officers did their level best to secure a posting far behind the lines, away from the dreariness and danger of the front. The winter of 1939 was the coldest in 50 years, making life at the front harsher still. Training and work routines were curtailed, which gave rise to idleness and then boredom. Amongst the BEF, where the officers insisted on keeping their men busy, morale was a good deal better. Their months of waiting were spent improving defence works and completing the training of the recently raised Territorial Army units. For the French soldiers, however, their army's ingrained defensive strategy added to its inertia and further sapped their fighting spirit. On May the 10th, the French army would go into battle with a fatal mix of apathy and disharmony. By the spring of 1940, there was a widespread belief amongst the French army that the war would be settled by diplomatic agreement, without a shot being fired. On May the 7th, normal leave was restored to the army. By now, relations between Paul Reynaud and General Gamelin had completely broken down, and on May the 9th, the French premier offered to resign because his government would not let him sack the general. In the wake of the Norwegian disaster, Britain's prime minister, Neville Chamberlain, was also preparing to resign. That same evening, the Luftwaffe informed Hitler, the weather on May the 10th will be good. Later that night, the code word Danzig went out to the already alerted German units, signaling that the long-awaited offensive would begin at 0535 hours. The long-gathering storm was finally about to break. On the 9th of May, 1940, all along Germany's western borders, the forces of the Wehrmacht were packing up and getting ready to move. Hitler's insistence on secrecy and speed was followed to the letter. Even frontline commanders were not informed of the offensive's launch until the last moment. In the early hours of May the 10th, Luftwaffe crews were roused out of their beds and told to be ready for action within 15 minutes. Before dawn, every available Luftwaffe plane was airborne. Meanwhile, long columns of panzers were leaving their quarters and driving along the approach routes to France and the Low Countries. At first light, the skies over Belgium and Holland were suddenly filled with the roar of Luftwaffe planes. Wave after wave of fighters, bombers, and transports swept over the frontiers. After 8 months of uneasy peace, war had finally come to the West. As he prepared to launch his great offensive, Adolf Hitler left Berlin with his entourage in his personal train. Despite the wariness that some of his generals continued to feel about the coming campaign, he felt supremely confident. He asserted that the French were too fond of easy living and lacked fighting spirit. He declared that by applying all means at its command, Germany could deliver one gigantic knockout blow. The German forces assembled along the Western Front were divided into three army groups. In the north was Army Group B, commanded by 55-year-old General Fedor von Bock, a First World War hero who came from a long-established military family. His forces were 18th Army, facing Holland, and 6th Army, facing northern Belgium. Army Group B totaled 29 divisions. three of which were armored, and two motorized. Amongst these formations were 4,500 paratroops and one airborne light infantry division. These units would play a key role in the coming offensive. Extending from Liège to Luxembourg was Army Group A under General Karl von Rundstedt, one of the Wehrmacht's most resourceful and flexible-minded commanders. A general since 1927, Rundstedt was highly respected within the army. His command was made up of 4th Army, 12th Army, and 16th Army. Altogether, Army Group A mustered 35 infantry divisions. Its key units, however, were the 7 armored and 3 motorized divisions which would form the vanguard of the attack. Nearly all of Germany's heavy panzers had been allotted to this massive armored phalanx. In the south, deployed opposite the Maginot Line, was Army Group C, commanded by Colonel General Ritter von Leib. Having left the army in 1938, he had been recalled from retirement on the outbreak of war. Army Group C's formations were drawn from 7th Army on the east bank of the Rhine and 1st Army in Lorraine. It had a fighting strength of 19 infantry divisions. Added to the ground forces was the formidable striking power of Hermann Göring's Luftwaffe. A prominent World War I flying ace, Göring had risen to be the highest ranking Nazi after Hitler himself. The Luftwaffe had over 3,000 planes committed to the Western Offensive. Army Groups A and B were each supported by a self-contained air fleet, comprising fighters, bombers, and reconnaissance aircraft. The Stuka dive bombers, which would provide close support artillery for the armor, remained under the centralized control of Göring. The Germans maintained a reserve strength of 42 divisions, of which 2 were motorized. This reserve was under the direct command of the commander-in-chief, General Walter von Brauchitsch. The Supreme Allied Commander, General Maurice Gamelin, had his headquarters at the Château de Vincennes on the outskirts of Paris. Gamelin had chosen Vincennes so that he could be close to his political masters, but it was nearly 100 miles from the front. It did not even possess a radio communications center. From this distant ivory tower, Gamelin surveyed the Allied forces poised to meet the German onslaught. On the extreme left, from the North Sea to Bayeux, was the French 7th Army under General Henri Giraud. 60 years old, Giraud was considered one of France's ablest generals. His army consisted of 7 elite divisions, including 2 motorized infantry and 1 light mechanized division. Next in line came the British Expeditionary Force, under Lord John Gort. Though subordinate to Gamelin, Gort had the right of appeal to his own government before carrying out any order which imperiled his force. The British Expeditionary Force's position stretched from Bayeux to Mold. It included 9 infantry divisions and 1 tank brigade, as well as supporting units. From Mold to the western end of the Maginot Line was Army Group 1 under General Biot. Biot would also be given the responsibility of liaising with the Belgian forces. Army Group 1 consisted of 1st Army, 9th Army, and 2nd Army. These formations comprised 21 divisions in all, including 14 infantry, 3 motorized infantry, and 6 light mechanized divisions. Holding the Maginot Line itself was Army Group 2 under General Pretelat. Pretelat's command numbered four armies, totaling some 44 divisions, one of which was British. The French General Reserve consisted of 22 divisions, including all three armored divisions and two motorized infantry divisions. Of this total, seven divisions, including two armored, were earmarked for Army Group 1. Another five infantry divisions were allotted to guard against a possible German strike through Switzerland. The French Air Force's planes were deployed in so-called zones of air operations, corresponding to the boundaries of the different army groups. The French Air Force numbered some 1,200 planes, comprising bombers, fighters, and reconnaissance craft. These were reinforced by 350 planes of the RAF. To the north, the Dutch Army mustered eight divisions with two more in reserve, and the Belgian Army fielded 18 divisions with an extra four in reserve. At sunrise on May the 10th, waves of Luftwaffe bombers struck at roads, railways, and airfields in Holland, Belgium, and France. While the Dutch frontier defenses were being attacked to the east, thousands of German paratroops and airborne troops were dropped over the key cities of Rotterdam and The Hague. These troops took the Dutch defenders completely by surprise and succeeded in capturing and holding the vital bridges on the Rhine until the mobile ground forces could come up. It was the first major attempt in history to conquer a country from the air, and the success of the airborne operation was vital to the whole invasion's outcome. To disguise the small numbers of their airborne troops, the Germans adopted the ruse of dropping dummy parachutists at scores of locations, effectively creating the impression of overwhelming numbers. The trick also helped spread panic and confusion amongst defending forces. The attack against Belgium was also spearheaded by paratroops, whose objectives were the two main bridges over the Albert Canal and the key fortress of Ebony-Mail. The fortress was the linchpin of Belgium's main line of defense. It dominated the Albert Canal, the main roads leading west, and the vitally important high bridges over the canal. Built between 1932 and 1936, it was regarded as the strongest fort in the world. Measuring 900 yards by 700, its fortifications were a tight complex of mutually supporting artillery and infantry installations. A series of forts with observation posts, searchlights, and machine guns was linked together by a network of tunnels. The only access to the network was through Fort 17. There were turrets with twin revolving cannon, retractable cannon, and rapid-fire guns. There were also anti-aircraft machine guns and dummy positions. On its northeastern side, a steep slope plunged 40 meters to the Albert Canal, providing complete security. On its northwestern side, the floodplain of the River Yaker had been raised by the fortifications. Extra security was provided by a steeply embanked trench containing machine guns, anti-tank cannon, and searchlights. Similarly equipped trenches faced west and south, and here there were also 4-meter-high walls. The Allies counted on Ebony-Mail holding out for at least 5 days, which would give their troops time to get in position on the Deal Line. The mission of capturing Ebony Mail was entrusted to a tiny but highly trained unit of 78 parachute engineers. The key element in the attack was the use of gliders, which transported the troops to their target in absolute silence. Attack from the air was the one thing Ebony Mail was not protected against. When the gliders crash-landed onto its roof in the dawn half-light of May the 10th, the defenders were taken completely by surprise. In the first 10 minutes, the Germans occupied 9 installations. They then blew up the casemates and cupolas of all the guns with a new, high-intensity, hollow-charge explosive. Finally, they kept the fort's garrison of 1,200 men pinned down until the arrival, 24 hours later, of the advanced troops from 6th Army. The capture of Ebony Mail was achieved with the loss of only 6 German dead and 15 wounded. It was a sensational coup. Afterwards, Hitler would decorate personally all the engineers who had taken part in the operation. About an hour and a half after the opening of the German offensive in the north, the French commander, General Gamelin, ordered the implementation of the Deal Plan. The units of the Allied First Army Group rolled across the Belgian border and advanced towards their allotted positions along the River Deal. Here they planned to halt the advancing Germans. Gamelin felt calm and confident, delighted that the Germans were attacking, just where he had guessed they would. On the Allied left, the French 7th Army raced northwards to link up with the Dutch as part of Gamelin's so-called Breda variant. By lunchtime the following day, they reached Tilburg, only to find their advance cut off by the 9th Panzer Division. The Dutch had already been forced to retreat northwards. Gamelin's Breda variant was thus negated at a stroke, and Giraud had no option but to fall back towards Antwerp. Along the River Deal itself, other Allied units were horrified to find that the defences were incomplete. Worst of all, the quick collapse of Ebony Mail had already forced the Belgians to start falling back toward the Deal, well before many of the Allied units had even got into position. As battle was being joined in the Low Countries, to the south, Army Group A's massive armoured formations were moving forward towards the Ardennes. These were arrayed in 3 densely packed blocks, with armoured divisions in the first 2 and motorised infantry in the 3rd. Altogether, their columns stretched out for 100 miles. Overhead, an immense umbrella of Luftwaffe fighters flew cover against any possible air attack by the Allies. But with Allied eyes fixed firmly on Belgium, no such attack came. Within 2 days, the mechanized spearheads of Army Group A erupted out of the Ardennes. Surging across the French border, they arrived at the banks of the River Meuse on the afternoon of May the 12th. The German forces in this sector comprised 3 panzer divisions and the elite Gross Deutschland motorized infantry regiment. For their imminent attempt to cross the river, they were promised overwhelming air support. Facing them were 10 infantry divisions drawn from the French 9th and 2nd Armies. These were woefully short of anti-tank and anti-aircraft artillery, and six of the divisions consisted of reservists, many of whom were over 40 years old. The successful crossing of the Meuse was vital for the German invasion. Only then would the panzers be able to fan out and operate on favorable ground. When the Germans launched their assault, the main effort was made just west of Sedan. On the afternoon of the 13th, 12 squadrons of Stukas struck and forced the French gunners on the far side of the river to retreat into their dugouts. At 4 p.m., detachments of panzer infantry in rubber boats began crossing the river. These units managed to secure a toehold on the opposite bank. By midnight, the Germans had driven a wedge 5 miles deep in the French defenses and built another bridge across which the panzers began to pour. On the 14th of May, Allied airstrikes were mounted against the German bridgeheads, but as in Belgium, ground flak units beat them off, inflicting heavy casualties. Indeed, in this engagement, the RAF incurred the greatest rate of loss it ever sustained in any single operation, losing 40 out of 71 planes. By that afternoon, all three panzer divisions, 1st, 2nd, and 10th, were across the river and had repulsed a French counterattack. Commanding them was General Heinz Guderian. Aged 52, Guderian was a pioneer of blitzkrieg tactics and its most outstanding exponent. Although the German High Command mistrusted Guderian's revolutionary theories, Hitler found them attractive and had sanctioned the earlier formation of panzer divisions. In command of an armored corps for the invasion of Poland, Guderian had played a key role in the German victory. His tanks achieved deep penetration with such incredible speed, they earned their commander the nickname Hurrying Heinz. Despite his success, the High Command continued to feel uneasy about Guderian's methods of striking into enemy terrain far ahead of infantry support. Consequently, when arrangements were being finalized for the Western offensive, they made his command subordinate to the more conservatively minded General Paul Ludwig von Kleist. With his tanks safely across the Meuse, a number of options were open to Guderian. He could wait for the infantry, who were still 36 hours away from Sedan, to catch up. He could push on towards Paris, or swing round to take the Maginot defenses from the rear. However, Guderian ordered 1st and 2nd Panzer to change direction and drive west toward the Ardennes Canal with the objective of breaking clear through the French defenses. The Ardennes Canal formed the hinge between the French 2nd and 9th armies, and if Guderian could breach that line, he would split apart the Allied armies and strike at the flank and rear of the forces moving into Belgium. The main danger was that the swing west would leave his left flank exposed, and he left the 10th Panzer and the Gross Deutschland Regiment to guard against any Allied counterstrike. Reacting to the German breakthrough at Sedan, the French ordered the crack 3rd Armored Division to attack the Sedan bridgehead on the morning of the 14th. However, it failed to reach its start lines until late that afternoon, and also found itself without artillery or infantry support. The local commander, 2nd Army's General Hunziker, called off the attack and ordered the division's tanks to be dispersed amongst his infantry units, thus dismantling the one Allied force which stood a chance of repelling the panzers. Hunziker also decided to pull back his left flank to guard against a German thrust into eastern France. This merely widened the Sedan breach from 5 miles to 15. Further up the River Meuse, German panzers had also crossed at Montermé and Dinan and severely battered the units of General Korab's 9th Army. The Dinan crossing had been made by 7th Panzer under the command of a 48-year-old Major General Erwin Rommel. By the evening of the 15th, Guderian's panzers had broken through the defences on the Ardennes Canal and the roads to the west lay open. Yet that very evening, Kleist, worried that Guderian's forces were overextended, ordered him to halt and confine his troops to the bridgehead already gained. Guderian argued forcefully against the order and received permission to continue the advance for another 24 hours in order to widen the bridgehead. With his customary boldness, Guderian made the most of this permission, advancing 50 miles as far as the River Oise. To his right, Rommel also advanced some 50 miles, capturing 10,000 prisoners and 100 tanks for the loss of only 35 killed and 59 wounded. At nightfall on the 16th, Guderian was again ordered to halt. Neither Hitler nor his high command could quite believe how easily the French had been overcome. They were still fearful of a strong counterattack against the vulnerable left flank, and Hitler insisted on Guderian waiting until an infantry corps could come up and form a flank shield. As Guderian's panzers were slicing through French defences to the south, in the north, the Germans were also gaining the upper hand. On May the 12th and 13th, the first major tank battle of the war took place. At Merdeau, the French First Army's two light mechanised divisions came into contact with powerful elements of the German 3rd and 4th Panzer Divisions, ably supported by Stuka dive bombers. On the first day, the French tanks did well, proving that on a one-to-one basis, they could match the much-vaunted panzers. The Samoas, in particular, could stand more than one hit by all but the heaviest German tank cannon. However, as the battle progressed, the panzers' superior tactics enabled them to outmaneuver the French repeatedly, and at nightfall on the 13th, the French tanks withdrew. That same evening, the tanks of the 9th Panzer Division reached the outskirts of Rotterdam, and the Dutch position, despite heroic resistance, became hopeless. The next day, following ferocious Luftwaffe bombing raids on Rotterdam, Holland capitulated. The German breakthrough on the Meuse reduced Gamelin's entire strategy to tatters. Realizing the extent of the catastrophe, French Premier Paul Reynaud phoned Winston Churchill early on the 15th to say, "We have lost the battle." Churchill insisted that the advancing panzers would have to stop soon to resupply, at which stage they could be attacked and cut off. The sheer speed of the German advance had thrown Gamelin and his commanders completely off balance. In trying to devise effective counterstrokes, they kept thinking in terms of infantry pace rather than panzer pace, and so were consistently too slow in responding to the changing situation. Time and again, they would designate a halt line where the German advance could be stemmed, only to find that the panzers had already passed that line. Early on the 15th, General Giraud was switched from the 7th Army to take over the shattered remnants of the 9th Army. Late that night, Gamelin, realizing the breach at Sedan was irreparable, ordered the whole Allied front in Belgium to be withdrawn to the line of the River Scheldt. Poor liaison meant that the BEF and the Belgians did not receive the order until the following day. On May the 16th, Paul Reynaud took steps to replace Gamelin and summoned General Maxime Weygand from Syria to assume command. Weygand was 73 years old and had been recalled from retirement just the previous year. He didn't reach France until May the 19th, causing a further delay in Allied attempts to devise effective countermeasures. In any case, Weygand's ideas were just as outdated as Gamelin's, and so his accession to the command saw no significant change in Allied tactics. Following the French collapse at Sedan, the British War Cabinet decided that they would send no more RAF fighters across the Channel. On May the 17th, the Royal Navy were informally asked to draw up plans for the possible evacuation of the British Expeditionary Force from France. In the south, on May the 17th, a counterattack was launched against the Panzer Corridor by Colonel de Gaulle's 4th Armored Brigade, but this was easily repulsed. On May the 18th, Guderian reached Peronne, while to the north, Rommel occupied Cambrai. That same night, General Giraud arrived at his new headquarters to find that the 41st Panzer Corps had got there before him. Early the following morning, he was captured by a German tank patrol. Later that day, de Gaulle's 4th Armored Brigade mounted another attack against Guderian's flank, but the panzers, well supported by Stukas, again beat him off. To the north, on May the 17th, Louvain and Brussels were occupied by the German 6th Army. As the Allied troops retreated westwards through Belgium, they began to threaten the right flank of the German advance. In the early hours of May the 20th, Rommel occupied the strategic heights near Arras. He was about to be attacked by the British Expeditionary Force. The offensive, launched on May the 21st, was supposed to be made by 2 British and 8 French divisions. However, the French were still not ready at the allotted time, and so the British had to attack on their own. With only 3 infantry battalions and 74 tanks. Nevertheless, they took Rommel's forward units completely by surprise and succeeded in driving them back 10 miles, destroying a large number of panzers. The German artillery could make little impression on the heavily armored Matildas, and in desperation, Rommel formed a gun line made up largely of flak 88s. Firing over open sights, the German guns finally stemmed the British advance. One 88 battery alone knocked out 9 British tanks. Heavy attacks by Stukas later that evening forced the British to withdraw. As the British Expeditionary Force were preparing to attack at Arras, General Weygand was startled to learn that Guderian's panzers had reached the Channel coast the previous evening. The Allied armies in the north were now completely cut off. After much debate, it was decided the Allies would fall back to a new front marked by Valenciennes, the River Escaut, the old frontier position from Mold to Allouin, and the River Lys. A strong offensive was also planned, involving a simultaneous strike from both north and south. While returning to his headquarters, General Biot was killed in a car crash, and it was not until the following day that his successor received the necessary orders. The French First Army was consequently behind schedule. As the Allies effected the withdrawal to their new positions, their progress was severely hampered by the flood of refugees fleeing the advancing Germans and continuous Luftwaffe bombing raids. On May the 22nd, Brachich ordered Army Group A to swing right. It was to head for a line through Armentières, Ypres and Ostend, cutting off the Channel ports as they advanced. Army Group B was to wheel its left flank around to face north, thus strengthening the walls of the trap. That same day, 2nd Panzer reached Boulogne, and on May the 23rd, 10th Panzer invested Calais. While fighting continued to rage around both ports, by May the 24th, 1st Panzer Division had reached the line of the Ahr Canal, barely 10 miles from Dunkirk. At this moment, the Germans were closer to Dunkirk than most British formations, and between them and their objective, there stood just one British Expeditionary Force battalion. Total victory was within the Germans' grasp. Yet as they stood poised to deliver the coup de grace, they were stunned to receive orders to halt. The order to halt was issued by General von Rundstedt on the evening of the 23rd, despite Brauchitsch's desire for a vigorous advance. Rundstedt wanted a pause to let his forces regroup. He had lost half his armor in the drive through France, though most of these losses had resulted from wear and tear rather than enemy action. Hitler not only approved his decision to halt the armor, he also gave orders that the halt be made permanent. As the panzers were driving ever deeper into France, Hitler had become increasingly edgy and nervous. He feared that at any moment, an Allied counterstroke could cut them off and deny him his imminent victory. Frightened by his own success, he preferred to pull the reins on his advancing columns rather than take any risks. Hitler may even have wanted to avoid destroying the BEF. While visiting Rundstedt, Hitler astonished his generals by speaking admiringly of the British Empire. He claimed all he wanted from Britain was that she acknowledged Germany's continental supremacy. Once France was defeated, Hitler assumed he could make peace with Britain. Sparing the British army would, Hitler believed, make that peace easier to reach. Above all, there was the influence of Hermann Göring. Göring was eager that the glory of the final victory should belong to the Luftwaffe. He argued that the Luftwaffe was much more loyal to the Nazi party than the army, and they therefore deserved the honor of the ultimate triumph. The Luftwaffe commander assured Hitler that his air force could finish off Dunkirk on its own. Göring's arguments gave Hitler the final justification he was looking for to halt the panzers. Since May the 20th, a huge flotilla of ships of all sizes was being assembled along England's Channel coast in case the British Expeditionary Force would have to be evacuated. These would later be augmented by thousands of small boats, essential for ferrying troops from shore to ship. Many of the small boats, which included yachts, lifeboats, trawlers, and more, were manned by civilian volunteers. The planned evacuation was codenamed Operation Dynamo and commanded by Vice Admiral Sir Bertram Ramsay. At 1900 hours on May the 26th, Ramsay was ordered to commence Operation Dynamo. He had been counting on three French ports being available for the evacuation, but by now, both Boulogne and Calais had been captured. With Dunkirk the only port remaining in Allied hands, Ramsay feared no more than 45,000 troops could be rescued. On the evening of May the 25th, Lord John Gort had ordered the British Expeditionary Force to retreat to the sea. His decision was prompted by the critical position of the Belgian army on the Allied left. It had already used up all its reserves and was on the brink of collapse. Once the Germans overran the Belgian line, they could then strike at the British army's exposed flank. Gort felt it was wiser to retreat than comply with Weygand's orders for an attack to the south. The following day, the Germans finally broke through the Belgian defenses. Just as importantly, Hitler gave permission for Army Group A to resume its advance. On May the 27th, the exhausted Belgian army could fight no further, and King Leopold asked the Germans for an armistice. By dragging out the surrender negotiations, the Belgians managed to buy their allies an extra 24 hours in the life or death race for Dunkirk. Nonetheless, it took hard and desperate fighting by French and British forces to keep their escape routes open. One British division was reduced to the size of a single brigade by nightfall on the 27th. The following day, the Belgians officially surrendered. At Lille, almost half of the French First Army, who had been slow to retreat, were cut off. Despite being surrounded, they chose to fight on, and over the next 3 days would tie down seven German divisions. That evening, the retreating Allies were hemmed into a narrow bridgehead around Dunkirk, and only 25,000 men had yet been evacuated. But the vast armada of small boats now began to arrive, enabling more and more troops to be rescued each day. Poor weather had hindered Luftwaffe operations during the early stages of the evacuation. The first heavy Luftwaffe raid did not come until May the 29th, but their attacks increased in intensity over the next 3 days. Though the RAF committed every available plane to provide fighter cover, they were heavily outnumbered. Nor could they stay long because of the distance from England. Luftwaffe attacks accounted for 243 ships, including 8 destroyers and 8 troop carriers. Luckily for the British Expeditionary Force, the Luftwaffe failed to put Dunkirk Harbour out of action. It was from the harbour, rather than the beaches, that the great majority of troops were embarked. Late on the 30th, the Germans finally realized the scale of Operation Dynamo. It was decided that an all-out effort must be made to break through the British Expeditionary Force defenses. On May the 31st, The Allies were forced to fall back to the line of defenses along the Franco-Belgian frontier. German pressure on the perimeter continued throughout the next day, and there were further massive assaults from the Luftwaffe. Yet again, the Allied rearguard was forced back, though they managed to prevent a German breakthrough. On June the 2nd, daylight evacuation had to be suspended because of the ferocity of Luftwaffe attacks. But by then, Operation Dynamo was nearly finished. That night, the last British troops were brought safely away. On June the 3rd, the Germans drove the French rearguard, numbering 30,000, into the outskirts of Dunkirk itself. That night, Ramsay's ships attempted to evacuate this last contingent. Their task was complicated by the sudden arrival of thousands more unarmed French troops. These had quit fighting earlier in the week and had since hidden in cellars, empty houses, and anywhere else they could around the port. Now, news of the Navy's last departure brought them streaming onto the beaches, desperate to get on board one of the final ships. In spite of all the ensuing confusion, 26,000 French troops were successfully evacuated. However, as the last ship sailed out of Dunkirk, nearly 40,000 men had to be left behind. This caused immense bitterness amongst the French, many of whom accused their chief ally of abandoning them. Nonetheless, Operation Dynamo had been an astounding success. A total of 338,000 Allied troops had been brought safely to England. Even though Britain had suffered a catastrophic defeat, Dunkirk took on an immediate mythic resonance for the British people. It symbolized their brave and resourceful resistance to German might. To that extent, Dunkirk had a profound inspirational effect, which helped Britain to continue fighting even when, as now, her position seemed hopeless. For while Britain had succeeded in rescuing her army from the brink of destruction, that army was currently in no condition to fight another campaign. Nearly all its heavy weaponry, transport and material had been abandoned, including 2,500 guns, 64,000 vehicles, and well over 500,000 tons of stores and equipment. With the cream of the Allied armies routed in Belgium, it could only be a matter of time before Germany finished off Wegen's remaining forces. In less than 4 weeks of fighting, the French had already lost 30 divisions and most of their armor. Their allies had also been defeated. As for the Germans, most of their infantry had scarcely been engaged yet, and the panzer divisions were now rested and refitted. They had already established large and solid bridgeheads at both Amiens and Peronne. All that faced them was another hastily constructed French line. Wegen's forces were deployed along the line of the Somme and Aisne rivers. 49 French divisions manned this front's 225 miles, with 17 more left in the Maginot Line. There were also four British divisions. Two of these had been isolated from Gort's main force and thus missed the Dunkirk evacuation, while the other two were newly arrived from England. The French forces included six much depleted mechanized and armored divisions, and the British also had one weakened armored division. The French were opposed by 130 German infantry divisions, including the fresh 2nd and 9th armies. The panzers were regrouped into five armored corps, each containing two panzer divisions and one of motorized infantry. Three of these corps were given to Army Group B in the west, one being commanded by Rommel and the other two by Kleist. The two remaining panzer corps, under Guderian, went to Army Group A in the east. To bolster his weak forces, Weygand ordered the construction of a checkerboard of closed operational bases called hedgehogs. These were installed in woods and villages and packed with artillery used in an anti-tank role. Even if outflanked, the hedgehogs were designed to be able to continue resisting. The German offensive opened in the west on June the 5th. The French put up a determined resistance, and the Germans had difficulty in subduing the hedgehogs. At last, on the 7th, Rommel's panzers broke through towards Rouen. French resistance in this sector promptly collapsed. Rommel had dealt with the hedgehogs by bypassing them completely and leaving them for the infantry to mop up. Army Group A's offensive began on June the 9th and also ran into stiff resistance. But that night, Guderian got his tanks across the Aisne. The next day, he widened his bridgehead, and with the remaining panzer divisions following through, the French defense gave way. Weygand's armies began to disintegrate on all fronts, and on June the 10th, Reynaud and his government left Paris. 4 days later, the Germans entered the city. On June the 16th, Reynaud resigned and a new cabinet was formed, headed by Marshal Philippe Pétain. 84 years old, Pétain had been one of the heroes of France's victory in World War I. In the present crisis, however, Pétain could see no point in prolonging the struggle. A request for an armistice was transmitted to Hitler. The following day, June the 17th, Pétain made a national broadcast instructing the French to stop fighting. By June the 19th, Rommel occupied Cherbourg, which marked the end of his campaign. In 6 weeks, his 7th Panzer, nicknamed the Phantom Division for its apparent ability to appear out of nowhere, had captured nearly 100,000 prisoners, as well as hundreds of guns and armored vehicles. His own casualties came to just over 2,500, of which fewer than 700 were killed. Only 42 of his tanks had been destroyed. In the east, Guderian's remorseless panzer drive quickly cut off all the French troops in the Maginot Line before pushing on to the Swiss border. To his right, Kleist's panzer corps crossed the Loire and penetrated as far as Lyon. On June the 20th, Hitler delivered his terms to the French envoys. Hitler's main objective was to cut France off from Britain. The northern part of France would be occupied by Germany and used as a base for continuing the war with Britain. The remainder would be governed from Vichy by a regime headed by Pétain. The French could keep their fleet and their colonies. Hitler had a humiliating surprise in store for the French. He had located the railway carriage in which the German commanders surrendered to the French at the end of the Great War. German engineers were ordered to hack down the walls of the museum in which the carriage was housed and bring it to the exact place it had stood on that famous occasion. There, in the forest of Retondes, 50 miles northeast of Paris, Hitler awaited the French delegation on June the 21st. when the French, led by General Hunziker, arrived and recognized the carriage, they were aghast. It was Hitler's supreme gesture of revenge. One German diarist later wrote, "The Battle of France is over. It has lasted 26 years." On June the 22nd, General Weygand authorized the acceptance of German terms, and the three French armies cut off in the east, a total of 400,000 men surrendered. At 12:35 a.m. on June the 25th, the fighting officially ceased. Though Germany had not asked for the handing over of the French fleet, Britain still feared its ships falling into German hands. On the 3rd of July, the Royal Navy attacked the main French squadrons, putting many ships out of action. This raid caused great bitterness and badly soured Anglo-French relations. The German conquest of the West had cost them just over 150,000 casualties, of whom only 27,000 were killed. Total Allied losses in killed and wounded came to 390,000, while 2 million more were taken prisoner. The Luftwaffe lost 1,284 planes and the RAF 931, more than half of which were precious fighters. The French Air Force had some 560 planes destroyed. The Germans also captured huge amounts of Allied equipment of all kinds. Germany's crushing victory confirmed its position as the supreme power in Western Europe. Their only remaining enemy, Britain, was isolated and much weakened. Hitler was convinced she would soon throw in the towel. Even before the armistice came into effect, he had ordered the demobilization of 35 divisions and the panzer groups were to be broken up. As far as Hitler was concerned, the war in the West was effectively over. Buoyed by his great triumph, Hitler was already starting to contemplate a campaign against the Soviet Union. Yet by letting the British Expeditionary Force slip through his fingers at Dunkirk, Hitler ensured that Britain could continue fighting. He was therefore about to lead Germany into a war on two fronts. His most spectacular victory thus sowed the seeds of his ultimate defeat.